They've been cherished under glass and worshipped by cultures around the world. Through the ages, their beauty has captivated our imagination and delighted our senses as central characters in literature, art, and philosophy. Butterflies are the most popular and mysterious creatures from the dark world of the creepy crawly. They have fascinated scientists and driven collectors to the brink of obsession. But what do we really know about the secret lives of these winged enigmas of the sky? As we trace the popularity of butterflies through history, we find that for many cultures, they are symbolic icons of life, death, and resurrection.
When you see a butterfly, you just stop for a moment and you can't believe that this delicate creature that is so beautiful is among us. They're enchanting, they're elusive, they're mysterious. They give us a sense of hope. There's something very soul-stirring when you see a butterfly. Aristotle, in 344 BC, in his Historia Animalum, defined the word psyche to mean both butterfly and soul.
Perhaps the spiritual relationship with butterflies and our psyche is connected to the mystery and magic that shrouds them like the chrysalid from which they all eventually emerge.
The origin of the English word butterfly. There were and still are many yellow butterflies in England. And so the people believe that these flying creatures were really fairies, who got their color from stealing the butter. So the butter flew away, thus butterfly was in Old English butterfluge, but evolved to butterfly.
Butterflies and caterpillars are often the first creatures to stir our young, curious minds about nature. For some, this curiosity has grown into a lifelong journey.
I can remember very clearly when I first chased a butterfly. I was about 7 years old. I lived in a small town in southern Ontario, and I spent an afternoon chasing a cabbage white butterfly around a school yard. I finally caught it in my cap, and I took it home, and I remember popping it into a jar and studying it and letting it go, and it's just built from that.
It's really amazing. I've been saving items with butterflies on them for over 40 years, and this can of beans, the label was made in 1880. I've ended up with close to 20,000 butterflies. When I first started, I was amazed at color and design and shapes and flight patterns. But as I started to examine it over the last four decades, I realized that it got me connected to geography, places around the world. Where did they come from?
The most recognizable butterfly on Earth is Danis plexippus, more commonly known as the monarch. After the monarch, though, the average person would be hard-pressed to name five other species of butterflies. In fact, worldwide, there are more than 17,000 species. North America is home to more than 750, like the silvery blue, tiger swallowtail, viceroy, red admiral, morning cloak, American painted lady, Baltimore checker spot, Milbert's tortoiseshell, question mark.
Butterflies are found in many places around the world. About the only place that you're not going to see a butterfly is on a ship out in the high seas or in the middle of Antarctica.
When you go north in Canada, the number of species of butterflies drops out. By the time you get into the islands of northern Canada, you're reduced to about 20 kinds of butterflies. And when you get to Alert, the very top of Ellesmere Island, you're down to two species of butterflies.
Warm temperatures, sunshine, and summer memories usually come to mind when we think of butterflies, not snow. But in northern temperate regions, several species like the morning cloak hibernate as adults. In early spring, it is one of the first creatures to stir from its deep sleep while there's still snow on the ground and long before there are any flowers with life-sustaining nectar. Instead, it feasts on the sap that runs from trees.
The mourning cloaks use a variety of behaviors and strategies to modify their body temperature. Strategies such as shivering, where they move the wings through very small arcs of movement quickly to muscularly generate some heat. They also bask in the sunshine and use the direct rays of the weak spring sun to warm the body. Most people wouldn't think of butterflies as being territorial. You wouldn't think of such a frail-seeming creature as being able to fight. But in fact, they do maintain territories. Mourning cloak butterflies defend territories early in the spring that are open areas in the woods. They're places where they can moderate their heat gain as best as possible. The simplest encounter between two male mourning cloaks would be a male entering an occupied territory and the defending male flies out to investigate. As soon as the intruding male realizes that the territory is occupied, he flies away. And the male butterfly then returns to the place that he started from, sets himself up in a nice place to bask so that he's ready for the next encounter. If, on the other hand, the male is an intruder who really wants the territory badly, then the defending male might have to be a little bit more vigorous in his defense to chase it around in circles around the perimeter of the territory or to eventually push it up further into the sky.
The stakes of these aerial dogfights are high. To the victor, the spoils of a secure territory to lure a mate. Procreation is complicated for all of Earth's organisms, and for butterflies, it's no exception. Their courtship rituals are quite involved and can be exhausting.
The assessment of not only species, but also sex and then willingness to mate can actually take quite a while and can involve a wide variety of behaviors. Butterfly courtship is a ritual that involves signals and responses, male sending signals and female receiving those signals and then responding back to them. The chief signal that they're using is pheromones, which is primarily just an odor. It's a chemical compound that is released through specialized glands on either the wings or the bodies that are then picked up by the female's antenna. And the strength of the pheromone message is also an indicator of how large a nuptial gift might be passed in the form of a spermatophore during mating. A spermatophore is a package of sperm, but it also includes a variety of other compounds that are given by the male to the female during mating and copulation.
Before male butterflies go courting, they visit their favorite watering hole.
Mud puddling is a stereotypical behavior that is very common in butterflies. Mud puddle clubs can be single-species assemblages or multi-species assemblages, and in some places can involve hundreds of butterflies. What butterflies are after in these mud puddles is salts, mineral salts. The females don't necessarily partake in this because the spermatophore that they receive during mating includes the salts that the male is collecting as part of the nuptial gift.
Butterfly releases at funerals and memorials are becoming an increasingly popular ritual in North America. But what lies behind this growing spiritual link between butterflies and death?
The butterfly represents that awareness, awakening, flight of the soul, the immortal soul. The Australian Aboriginals have a story when death first occurred on the planet, they were sure that the soul was released from the body, and the caterpillars volunteered to go up to the sky to see what happened to all the dead people. and they returned as butterflies.
When somebody releases a butterfly, something kind of almost spiritual happens. It's a very tough thing to put into words. It's releasing something live, and it's free. For a lot of people, it's very emotional, and butterflies seem to bring a lot of closure to people at memorials and funerals.
People tell me stories all the time that when someone is passed on, a butterfly will come and reassure them and lighten their heart and give them a great sense of peace and hope that their loved one is living on in the form of a butterfly.
I think it symbolizes hope that one day we will be changed. Right now, like the caterpillar, we're in this attire. But if we have faith and we believe, then one day when we die, we will take on a new form. It's just so magical. It's so mysterious.
There are so many stories of butterfly lore from all parts of the planet. In Ireland in the 1600s, a white butterfly represented the soul of a departed child. In Romania, girls mixed a drink of butterfly wings, hoping that if they imbibed that, they would attract a suitable lover. When Ferdinand Marcos was on his deathbed, it was reported in all the Filipino newspapers that a black butterfly had been seen flying into his palace, and everyone knew that he was soon going to die, which is what happened.
From Caribbean festivals to sacred native North American tribal dances, butterflies continue to profoundly affect the human spirit, just as they have in the past.
The Blackfoot Native Americans say that when a butterfly lands on you, you should whisper a wish to it. Since it doesn't speak, it will carry your wish directly to the Great Spirit.
I dreamt I was a butterfly, fluttering hither and thither. To all intents and purposes a butterfly, suddenly I awoke, and there I lay myself again. Now I do not know whether I was then a man, dreaming I was a butterfly, or whether I am now a butterfly, dreaming I am a man. Many species of insects undergo extraordinary metamorphoses, but none instill the same awe-inspiring wonder as the metamorphosis of butterflies. Their change from lowly caterpillars into celestial flowers of the air is the reason they have been revered through the ages as metaphors of resurrection and transcendence. And it all starts with a single upright egg.
Female butterflies that are already mated are ready to lay eggs. And to lay eggs, they need to find a suitable plant to lay the egg on that they know that their caterpillar can survive on. So a female will look at plants and will assess them by size, shape, and color, and a variety of things. And they'll stop on a leaf and they'll actually taste with the taste receptors that they have in their feet for specific chemical compounds that will help them to identify those plants. If she doesn't find them, then she'll fly on and seek another plant. If she does find them, then she'll investigate that plant a little more thoroughly, looking for younger leaves or flowers specifically, or the presence or absence of ants or other predators. If all of those conditions are met, then she'll choose to lay an egg. The caterpillar is completely and totally dependent on the choices that the female butterflies make. And if she makes a bad one, then the caterpillar isn't going to survive. So she has to be very good at what she does. Butterflies are pretty good chemists. They have very sensitive tastes on the levels of one part per million, or even one part per billion. Only one or two of each 100 eggs that a butterfly lays will survive to become a butterfly itself. Ecologists think of it in terms of replacement rate. They think that every pair of sexually breeding organisms must replace themselves with another male and another female to maintain population sizes. Butterflies barely manage to do that.
For the eggs that do survive, the larvae, more commonly known as caterpillars, have one mission in life: to eat, eat, and eat some more, gathering the necessary fuel they need to enter the next phase of their incredible lives.
Caterpillars can best be described as stomachs on legs. They are an open-ended tube with a mouth at one end and an anus at the other, and what goes in one end comes out the other end with very little change. Caterpillars grow and develop rapidly. They're very efficient at translating plant tissue into caterpillar tissue.
If a human baby ate and grew at the same rate as a caterpillar, in 1 month, that baby would be the size of a two-story house and weigh several tons.
Predators like caterpillars. Caterpillars are good food. So caterpillars have had to develop ways to avoid predators. One of the ways that they do this is to blend into their background. They can look like things that are inedible, like bird droppings. They can also look like things that are dangerous. Caterpillars might camouflage themselves by living within a rolled leaf that's held together with silk. Or in the case of the harvester, they take the filaments off of their aphid prey and put them on their own back so that they in turn look like an aphid. Silvery blue caterpillars associate with ants because the ants protect them. The way that they gain the protection of these pugnacious bodyguards is to provide the ants a nectar from an organ on their abdomen, and the ants in turn protect the caterpillars from insects that might like to try and carry the caterpillar off.
But how do caterpillars attract the ants in the first place? Amazingly, one of the ways is through vibrations. Groundbreaking studies on moth caterpillars, thought silent until now, have revealed that they do indeed communicate, a capability scientists believe butterfly caterpillars also possess.
Until now, we have thought of caterpillars as being the feeding machines of the moths and butterflies. They're just there for eating. They don't have so interesting social structure. They don't have interesting behavior. Now we're actually finding that they have many reasons to communicate with one another, and vibrations are probably one of their principal means of communication. There are two well-known examples of caterpillar communication. One is the caterpillar called the masked birch caterpillar. It's a hook-tip moth caterpillar. They actually fight and they go into these ritualized acoustic duels. They drum their mandibles, they scrape oars against the leaf, and they scrape their mandibles back and forth.
When a caterpillar sheds its final exoskeleton and mutates into a chrysalid, it is already well on its way to becoming a butterfly. Depending on the species, it takes 4 to 14 days for the final transformation from beast to beauty. Surprisingly, for all the exhaustive studies conducted on butterflies, no one has ever captured on film what really goes on inside a chrysalid until now.
The process of metamorphosis from caterpillar to chrysalis to butterfly, if one pays attention, is there to see. And it's absolutely miraculous.
Science, and its penchant for classifying things, is unable to give a single name to the creature that undergoes the four-stage process which ultimately produces an adult butterfly. Somehow, that seems fitting for this phenomenal organism that has stirred our imaginations since the beginning of time.
The four-stage life cycle of butterflies is very discrete. An egg is obviously not a caterpillar, and a caterpillar is very obviously not a chrysalid, which is very obviously not a butterfly. As soon as the caterpillar hatches out of the egg, small areas of undifferentiated cells that are called imaginal discs actually begin assembling the adult features of the butterfly. They start making wings, and these wings are there in very small, almost unrecognizable form throughout the entire life of the caterpillar. And it's only when they enter the pupal stage that these changes accelerate.
This is the first time anybody's taken a chrysalis and looked at it during various stages of its development using magnetic resonance imaging, which is a relatively new technology that's more commonly used for medical purposes. And using MRI, you can see that even from day one, the future tissues, you can already identify them. They may be very liquid and very amorphous, but they're there. You can see the brain of the butterfly, the eyes. You can see a digestive tract mostly, very little reproductive tissue, no flight muscles to speak of.
The MRI tracks the astonishing changes taking place inside the living chrysalid, providing a revealing perspective of metamorphosis never seen before. By day six, the caterpillar's digestive tract has diminished in favor of reproductive organs, signifying a shift towards adulthood. By day 10, the flight and leg muscles, not visible at day 4, are now fully developed, ready to support the butterfly as it climbs out of its chrysalid and prepares for its inaugural flight. When the miracle of metamorphosis is complete, the eclosing, or rupture, of a chrysalid is one of nature's most sublime moments. It happens in secret, hidden under leaves, and rarely witnessed by humans. What emerges is a totally different creature, destined to begin its extraordinary life as a butterfly. Just like snowflakes, no two butterfly species are identical. A marvelous diversity of wing patterns exist in all species. Upper and lower wing surfaces are usually quite different, each with their own unique designs. And if you look very closely, images of letters, numbers, and even faces can be seen within the multitudes of dazzling wing patterns. In the secret world of butterflies, their wings have much to say. To butterflies of the same species, wing patterns are the equivalent of the personals, identifying compatible mates from all the other butterflies they encounter. To predators, such as birds, rodents, lizards, and spiders, colors and wing patterns transmit a very different and immediate message.
Butterflies avoid predators in a variety of ways. The simplest and most obvious is to run away. Another way that you might is to hide, to fade into the background, to be camouflaged, or to be cryptic. Another way is to be brightly colored or warningly colored in such a way that you're telling the predator that you might not be good to eat. The monarch protects itself by feeding on milkweeds that contain noxious compounds, and then they incorporate those compounds within their own bodies. When the predator attacks, it quickly learns that anything that's black and orange is something that it should avoid in the future. The viceroy looks like the monarch primarily to gain protection from the monarch's protection.
The deception the viceroy employs against predators is known as mimicry. While some species like the viceroy are clever con artists, others rely on a strategy known as flash and conceal.
The Milbert's tortoiseshell, for instance, is brightly colored on the top so that when it opens up its wings, a predator is looking for bright colors. But when it closes its wings and all you see is the underside of the wings that look like a dead leaf, all of a sudden those colors disappear and the search image of the predator literally vanishes into the background.
What we've got here are dead leaf butterflies found in Malaysia, Taiwan, China, and the best example of butterfly camouflage in the world. When they rest on a branch, they look like leaves.
The famous American author and lepidopterist Vladimir Nabokov once eloquently remarked, "Literature and butterflies are the two sweetest passions known to man." Butterflies have been featured in poems by William Blake, Edna St. Vincent Millay, and Pablo Neruda, immortalized on canvas by Rossetti, Picasso, Warhol, and Van Gogh, and idolized in music and popular culture.
Made with wings of butterflies. In some countries, people use the wings of dead butterflies that they find along the sides of the roads, and they put pictures together. Both these pieces are from Thailand. This is a real collector's piece. This is from the 1800s. Matter of fact, 1899. And there's a family portrait inside the wings of butterflies. I didn't realize it, but after 40 years, I took a tally of all the stamps that I had, and I have 62,000 stamps with butterflies on them.
Much like ourselves, the majority of the world's butterflies are quite content to live out their lives in the same place without ever changing their address. But of the 200-odd butterfly species that migrate to other locations, the two that rack up the most air miles are the Painted Lady and the Monarch.
From the time of the Aztecs and perhaps before, this is the story of the Day of the Dead. When the monarchs return from Canada and the United States to Mexico every year, as they have for millennia, they arrive around the 1st of November, All Saints Day, Los Dios de Muertos, the Day of the Dead, where everyone in Mexico goes to the cemeteries to communicate and celebrate with their departed loved ones.
Monarchs are able to migrate the large distances that they do because they have a number of adaptations that allow them to do so. One of the most important is reproductive diapause. The migratory generation of the monarch that emerges in the north comes out with their reproductive organs not fully developed, and that means that the energy that they would normally put into reproduction can be put into flight. They also live 6 to 7 times the length of time that the average generation of a monarch does.
My studies are primarily on the monarch butterfly because I'm interested in the flight tactics that they use to get from here all the way to Mexico while gaining weight. They are so effective in traveling that they actually increase their lipid mass during the trip. About half a dozen species migrate in North America. The monarch butterfly is the best known, but other species like the red admiral, the painted lady, the question mark, which is an actual butterfly, these also migrate. Check out that vulture over there. Notice it's not flapping its wings. It's got a column of rising air turning sharply to stay within it. No wing flaps. That's exactly what the monarch butterflies do. Soaring both allows them to travel great distances and allows them to travel these distances cheaply, that is, without using very much of their own energy.
A group of researchers set out to answer a simple but elusive question. How do monarchs know where they're going? Their study had some far-reaching results.
Through this tethering mechanism in the optical encoder, we can recreate the virtual path that the butterfly takes with all its loops and twists and turns. As the butterfly flaps in this gentle breeze and turns around, the computer gets a trace of the path, where they start and where they finish. And when we did this, all of our migrating monarch butterflies tended to take a southwesterly direction. In fact, that's the direction that will take them from here in Kingston, where we tested them, to the mountain in Mexico where they spend the winter. So we figured that the butterflies might be using the sun as a compass. We run the experiments outside so they can see the sky, and we only ran on sunny days. Some of the butterflies that we brought indoors, and over a period of a week or so, we shifted the light on them. We turned the lights on at midnight and off at midday. So then when we flew them in the apparatus, instead of going southwest, they went southeast. So this showed that the butterflies have a sun compass and a time-compensated sun compass.
Butterflies, like frogs, are nature's barometers about the health of our planet. Once, a cloud of several billion monarchs converged annually to the mountains of Mexico. Now they only number in the millions. What could cause such a radical decline? Because of relentless habitat degradation and food loss, the monarch's extraordinary migration is regarded by many experts as an endangered phenomenon.
Habitat loss is something that occurs at both ends and all along the journey for monarchs. Habitat loss at the Mexican overwintering grounds is pretty dramatic. They're in a very small area, only about 50 square miles of Mexico.
The populations have just been so devastated the last few years, and the forests continue to be cut, and the bad weather continues to play havoc with the populations. But the populations of monarchs that winter on the west coast of California and populations of monarchs that are resident in Central America do not seem to be endangered. So it's not endangered as a species, but the monarch that everyone has sort of knows and loves in eastern North America is very definitely endangered and could well disappear in the next 20 years.
Butterflies can be the modern day equivalent of canaries in coal mines. The loss of butterflies in particular areas where they once occurred tells us that things weren't as they once were, and that is a pretty good indicator that something is wrong.
I often describe butterflies as being a barometer of the environment. And by that I mean they can indicate the general health of the environment basically by their numbers and the number of species or the diversity that you find them in. Butterflies that are on the decline may indicate that our environment is in trouble through pollution, global warming, certainly agricultural activities, the use of pesticides, degradation of the environment through construction, that type of thing.
Butterflies are creatures of habits and habitats. They've developed those habits over millennium in order to better survive, and unlike people, they can't really change their habits.
Research is being done and has been done that actually shows that already global warming has affected the range of butterflies and that butterflies are moving north and they're going to reach a point where there's nowhere left to go. There's only so far north that you can go.
Butterfly conservatories are often the only places where humans and these winged wonders from around the world have the opportunity to get up close and personal.
Butterfly Conservatory serves a number of functions. Number one, it is an attraction. It's a place for family to come and enjoy nature and the beauty. I also believe it to be a learning center, and we definitely put forth the message that we as humans need to show responsible stewardship for the earth.
The role that butterfly conservatories have, they educate people, they help people appreciate the magnificence of the beauty of butterflies, they're inspirational.
As we become more aware and sympathetic of the plight and needs of butterflies, millions of enthusiasts have created butterfly gardens to attract, feed, and enjoy their ephemeral beauty. One of the most famous butterfly gardeners of the past was Winston Churchill. His garden was a solitary retreat from the world where he could enjoy his lifelong fascination with butterflies.
Butterfly conservation is actually a very easy thing to do. Butterflies are small. And that means that they don't need large areas of land set aside for them. You don't have to lay out the area of Yellowstone Park because butterflies are not grizzly bears.
I was reading not too long ago that the fastest growing recreational activity in North America is gardening. But close to that is nature observation. And what butterfly gardening does is it combines the two and it gives residents, landowners, the opportunity to both garden and study and build for nature at the same time. There was a film that was made called Field of Dreams. And in that film, Kevin Costner had built a baseball diamond to bring back the old-time ghost players. In essence, a butterfly garden, you try to do the same thing. If you build it, they will come.
The Chinese believe that a jade butterfly symbolizes the love and union of two souls. Butterfly releases at weddings hold much the same meaning and have launched a multi-million dollar industry that not only supplies weddings but funerals, research facilities, and zoos.
I worked at a mutual fund company on an evening shift and I hated it. And I came home and surfed the internet, and I saw a woman in Hawaii that released butterflies for weddings. And I thought, if I ever get married, I'm gonna have butterflies at my wedding. And about a week later, I saw somebody in Philadelphia that started this industry. So I got information from him, and that was the start. Before I was in this business, I never picked up a butterfly. Now I can do four at a time. The butterflies are $125 a dozen, probably going up next year. I call them flying $10 bills. Speaking of flying, there's one. In a season from the end of May, beginning of October, I probably raise 5,000 to 7,000 butterflies, and they all go to brides all across Canada.
Butterfly releases at weddings are a beautiful and seemingly innocuous gesture, but some experts believe they can produce serious consequences.
And the idea of just letting butterflies fly out at a wedding is in some ways so much more attractive than confetti and things like that. However, we don't really understand what effects all of these releases are having on the natural genetic integrity of the butterflies or on the natural distribution of the butterflies.
Certainly, there are dangers. East Coast monarchs migrate. West Coast monarchs do not migrate. So what happens when you mix the two species? Some very major issues.
The concerns of the scientific community are also shared by butterfly breeders like Ken McGrath. As a member of the Canadian Butterfly Breeders and Exhibitors Association, he ascribes to their standards for raising and releasing butterflies. The codependent relationship between insects, such as butterflies, and plants is highly evolved and essential for each other's survival. Butterflies, equipped with a coiled proboscis that acts like a straw, suck up nectar from flowers, which typically have sugar concentrations between 15 and 25%. After learning how to locate and unlock the nectary of a particular flower, some species will remain faithful to it and forgo searching out others. How we see the vibrant colors of flowers is not at all how insects see them. Flowers use ultraviolet patterns that are invisible to the human eye to attract pollinators. Dandelions, which appear bright yellow to us, appear almost purple to a butterfly or a bee. This additional color, known as bee purple, is increasingly brighter towards the dandelion's center, acting as a homing device for nectar-hungry insects. To the average person, the idea of saving an insect from extinction is a bizarre cause to rally behind, but not for a group of dedicated Canadian and American biologists. More than 24 butterfly species are in peril in North America, including the magnificent Karner blue.
Well, the Karner blue butterfly, it disappeared from Canada in 1992. It is a small species of butterfly, about an inch across when it's flying.
The Karner Blue Recovery Program is part of a North America-wide initiative to bring this endangered species back to sustainable numbers.
Our initiative here at the zoo will be to work first on the Karner Blue and then later on other extirpated species from Ontario.
Why is it so crucial for biologists to save even one tiny species of butterfly from extinction? Because much of what we know about the ecology of insects and the evolution of animal behavior comes from the study of butterflies.
The poem of John Donne, For Whom the Bell Tolls, talks about the interconnectedness of life. And what we realize is that butterflies are part of an ecosystem that interacts in ways that we're only beginning to understand. And so when one thing disappears, we really don't know what that translates out as in terms of the destructive effects on the whole population and the whole ecosystem.
We're not even close to knowing all that there is to know about butterflies. We've barely scratched the surface. There are still entire species that have yet to be named. We still don't know what the food plants of many butterflies are. The egg stages and caterpillar stages and pupal stages, which we don't notice as often, are in many cases undescribed.
Now we have the tools to explore these secret lives of butterflies and caterpillars, and there'll be a lot of new research coming out in the next 10 years or so.
In Mexico, there is a wonderful creation myth of how the first gods and goddesses were led from a place in the north by butterflies to a sacred mountain, where they built a huge bonfire to prepare to bring light to the world. And one of the gods jumped into the fire to become the sun, and another god jumped into the fire to become the moon. And now that we have light in the world, how are we going to adorn this world and prepare the world for humans? And Quetzalcoatl, the plume butterfly, said, "I will give my life," and jumped into the flames to become the many colored butterflies and flowers of the earth. And this is how the world was prepared.